In this video tutorial, we are going to build this data grid, which allows the user to select and mark rows with a checkbox. There is a checkbox in the header as well for selecting or deselecting the entire grid. Let's look at the structure of the files in our application. We have a subfolder called Themes, where we have placed the CSS themes for the grid. Note that we have two sets with 9 themes. The themes in both sets are with the same names. The one defines the styling for the grid, the other for the UI. Then we have a JSON file, which contains the data for the grid. It has 48 records, and each one is for a supplier with made-up name and some info about the orders and their company data. Now, in a blank HTML file, we add references to these CSS themes. Whichever theme we decide to use, we need to add the same one for the UI and for the grid. In our case, we add 2 themes, so we can choose later which one will stay. At the end of the web page, right before the closing body tag, we add references to all JavaScript files that were in the scripts folder. Then we add references to the JS file with the JSON data and the code behind file, which is empty for now. The last thing, which we are going to add to the web page, is a div element, which will represent the grid. We will bind it to the grid object, and we need to be able to refer to it. That is why we provide it with an ID. The first thing we do in the JavaScript file is to add a reference to the file with TypeScript definitions of the API. We do it in order to use IntelliSense. We also add some namespace mappings, which will make our code more readable. Next, we create an array that will hold all columns for the grid. Then we create the first column, an instance of the grid column class. We set its data type property to integer type and make it non-editable. We set its caption and add it to the columns array. Now I will just paste the code for the second column. It is identical to the first one, but it is of string type and can be edited. The third column is of lookup type, which means the value is chosen among several values. The column can render a combo box for the user to select a value. Let's go to the online documentation now and check the metadata property of grid column. It is of type map, and here in the sample code, we can see how we can set the values to choose from. We copy the code and change the name of the array to suppliers and the field to state. Then we add the third column to the columns list. The fourth column is for the date. It is of date type, and we can use again its metadata property, but this time to specify custom editor. We set its autocomplete values and allow empty input properties to true. We add 2 more columns. One is integer and the other is of currency type. It is time to create the grid. It is an instance of the grid class, and we use the reference to the div element that we defined in the web page. We set the width of the grid to be 90% of the page width and set its theme to be light. Now we will set an array model as a model for the grid. Array model is just one of the data models that a grid can have. We create a new array model with the supplier's data list, the columns, and index as the key column. Now we need only to call render and our grid must visualize. Here it is. When we want to edit the third column, a list with the options appears. When we want to edit the date time column, a drop-down calendar editor is rendered. We can change the theme by changing the value of the theme property to the name of the other CSS files that we included, Pastel. The grid appears in different colors. The editors look different as well. We only have to implement the last column, which will render the checkbox. This type of columns is created with the help of commands. You can see in the sample code in the online documentation that each command must derive from the CommandBase class. It must implement a property called name and a method called createControl. This method returns the control to be rendered in each cell. In our case, we will return an input control of type checkbox. Note that if the checkbox is selected, we add the data of the row where the action occurred to a new array called selected suppliers. Initially, this list selected suppliers is empty. Its purpose is to keep the data of all rows whose checkbox is ticked. We create our last, seventh grid column, which is of command type. We use once again the metadata property to set a value for a key called commands. The value is an instance of the select command class, which we've just created. When we refresh the grid, the new column with checkboxes is already visible. This is excellent, but when we tick a checkbox, the row is not selected, just the cell. Let's change that. We need to handle the row command event, which provides a list with useful event data. We check if the event was triggered by the checkbox and we add or remove the row data for the current row. We need to call refresh rows to make the grid update its appearance. We need to handle also the row rendered event. In it, we check if the index of the row that is being rendered is in the list with selected rows. If so, we change the background of the whole row to light gray. If it is not, we leave the background color empty. Now, if we reload the page, we can select whole rows by ticking the checkbox. We can add one more feature to this grid. Let's render a checkbox in the column header. When users check or uncheck it, the whole grid will be selected or deselected. We need to handle the custom draw header event, where we can replace the default rendering for our column header with custom HTML code. We create an input control of type checkbox. We need to check if all rows have been manually selected. If so, we check it automatically. If they aren't, the checkbox must be unchecked. Then we add an event listener for the change event. This is a method called toggleSelection, and we will write it shortly. Then we append the checkbox and a text to the div element, which we created first. We refresh the page, but the header is unchanged. And the reason is we need to include the new code before the render method. So we call render at the end of our code. Now the header is visible. Let's add the toggle selection method. It is a simple one. It removes all elements from the selected suppliers list. Then, if the header checkbox is ticked, we add all supplier records to the selected suppliers list. Now we can select and deselect all grid records with a click. And this is the end of this video tutorial. Thank you for watching, and thank you for your interest in Mind Fusion Developer Tools.